since Jesus came into my heart. Singing 684. We'll sing both verses. 684. Precious Lord, take my hand. Amen. 684. Precious Lord, take my hand.
That's the first time I've heard that psalm. That's a good one. I like it. Take my hand, Lord. It's good to see you this morning. Welcome to Truth Baptist Church. It is a blessing to be together here today. We're so glad you decided to come and be with us on this cold, rainy, super Sunday and making it a priority. We're glad that you're here. I want to mention several things. First of all, it's good to see the t-shirts here, and we're so glad that they're here. And if you did not get a chance to say hello to Cullen, please do that, and what great progress he has made. God has been incredibly good to him, and he has a great spirit and a great attitude about everything, and Erica is here, and the girls, and little Elias. We're so glad for all of them, and the Lord has brought their whole family through so much, and God has proven himself to be good and faithful through it all, and so we're glad to see you, all of you. And they've been in this journey together. And, you know, really, I think, aren't you in the 2 percentile or something like that of people who survive what you've gone through? That's without a doubt the hand of God. And so praise the Lord. Amen. Glad to have you folks here. And it means so much to have you with us here at Truth this morning. Also, I wanted to mention, I don't want to forget to say this, BJ is going to be active duty, full active duty Army, traveling today to go to, is it this week or today that you're going to Missouri? Tomorrow, okay. going to Fort Lee today so that you'll be taking off traveling tomorrow. And so we want to pray for him as he continues in the Army there. And let's make sure we send him off, letting him know how much we care about him and what he's facing and what he's going through. And it's an important position to be representing our country overseas or wherever they might be, whether it's here, home, or abroad. And we're going to be praying for BJ as he continues to follow the Lord's will there, being in the Army. Amen. And although we're not in that army per se, we're all in the Lord's army, aren't we? And we all have a responsibility to live for the Lord. It's good to have you. Let's pray and ask the Lord's blessing on this service together. Father, we thank you for this time to be together, worshiping in this place. Thank you for those you've brought here today, whether first-time visitors or long-time members or, Lord, friends that we've not seen in a while. What a blessing it is to have the T-shirts here. Just feels right. And Lord, thank you for how you brought Cullen this far and continue to bring him along. What a miracle that is. He's a living miracle. And Lord, I pray that you would continue to have your hand on him, have your hand on BJ as well, and the importance of representing our country and being in the Army. I pray that you would help him in all that he has ahead and what he'll be doing and dealing with. And Lord, I pray that you would meet with us today and speak directly to our hearts from your word. As we approach this week, we think of love. And oftentimes we get a wrong idea of what love is. Help us this morning to truly have an accurate picture of the love of God. And I pray that we would apply that and emulate it and seek to have that same love ourselves. Give us a great day today together, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward here today. And if you are visiting for the very first time, we want to say welcome. Thank you for being here with us. It's our pleasure and joy to have you visiting here. And right now, as our ushers make their way down the aisle, don't be shy. Just raise your hand very quickly if you are visiting for the first time. If you've never been here before, we want to give to you a visitor welcome card. Just raise your hand if you would. And we ask that you fill out the information on the card. If you can, put it in the offering plate as it comes by. But my wife and I will be in the lobby after the service, and we hope to get a chance just to say hello and to be able to meet you and see and know who you are. And so we hope we get a chance to do that. Thank you for being with us today. It's our joy to have visitors this Sunday, as well as just about every Sunday. It's a blessing to have you here with us. There's not an actual handout bulletin today, but several things I want to make mention of. Remember that if you are a single adult, there is going to be a gathering over at Anna's after the service this morning, okay? So just go and ask for the Truth Baptist group if you're new. Rebecca Search, you can talk to her about where they're meeting up or where in the restaurant to go. But that group, if you're single, if you're unmarried and you're out of high school, anyone in that group from post-high school all the way through 100, okay? Even 100 plus, all right? You can be a part of that. So that'll be a good time for that group. We had a wonderful sweetheart dinner also at Anna's this past Thursday night. It was a great time together. Just had a lot of fun and a time of fellowship, and God was certainly good to us there. As our ushers come forward, remember, I want to ask you to please make it a point to mark down March 10th through the 12th. Friday, March 10th through Sunday, March 12th. That's going to be our family conference. We're going to meet together Friday night, Saturday night, as well as Sunday all day for our Sunday school hour, our morning service, and our evening service. I want to ask that you would clear aside the calendar, make sure that those dates are a priority. You might say, I'm single. I'm going to the singles lunch. Family conference doesn't pertain to me. Oh, yes, it does. Yes, it does, because we never know how our situation might change. But if you are single, you're still an individual family unit, and you're not all by yourself. If you know the Lord, you have the Lord with you. And so just keep these things in mind I hope that those dates will be important to you and that you will make them a priority. We're looking forward to what the Lord will do, speaking through Dr. David Dice as he will be with us. And then remember, this evening's service, we are having it, but it's going to be 5 o'clock instead of 6 o'clock. I said last week, are you doing that because of the Super Bowl? Yes, I am. I am doing that because of the Super Bowl, so I have no qualms about saying that. I think it would just be wise for us to move the service back early. We're not canceling the service. We're just moving it back, and that way we can kind of adjust accordingly. I know that people are hustling and bustling and trying to get to, you know, parties or people's houses, and it's kind of it's a big social event. It's an American event, and so I want to try to accommodate that as much as possible, just for practicality's sake, if nothing else, being careful on the roads, getting back home at a good time, and all that sort of thing, okay? So remember that. We'll be done before 6 o'clock. You might even have time to get your wings and get home, all right? And I say that because that's what we're going to do. We're going to find some wings, and we're going to get home, and we'll have a good time with that. It's time for us to be to pray for the morning offering, and Brother Chick Burcham, would you pray for the offering, please?
Thank you.
different song. I know we have hymn number, let's see, what did I had down here? A Shelter in a Time of Storm. But, you know, the Lord just kind of impressed on me. Let's do 508 as we stand. Love Lifted Me. 508, as we stand, we'll sing all three verses and sing it out. Love Lifted Me.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from a peaceful shore.
If love really lifted you, now just, you know, it ought to be picking you up. Some are doing it. You know, let's join them. Yeah, love lifted me, right? All right, let's try it. Here we go.
All my heart to him I'll give, never to him I cling. In his blessed presence still, ever his praises sing. Love so mighty and so true, there is my soul's best song.
That.
When nothing else can help, love lifted me.
There you go.
Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me.
On the third.
Souls in danger look about. Jesus completely saved.
Pastor really got lifted on that one. All right. Let's take to our course now, do our course. I Love You, Lord. Isn't that a good song? Amen. We're going to sing that through. Then we'll turn around, shake hands with one another, and come back and sing it again.
I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to
shake hands with one another. As we make our way back to our seats, let's sing through this one more time. Hymn number 78, I Love You, Lord.
I love you, Lord.
Amen. Thank you, ladies, for that song. Children can be dismissed to junior church up through fifth grade. Children up through fifth grade can be dismissed to junior church. That was a wonderful song, and I believe perfectly appropriate for today as we are thinking about love, and specifically the love of the Lord. We're in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. We're taking a one-week departure from our series, traversing through the Gospel of Matthew. And I believe because of the time of year that it would be appropriate for us to look at 1 Corinthians chapter 13. This message is going to take the place of the message I would preach on this chapter going through the 1 Corinthians series on Sunday nights, because we are preaching through 1 Corinthians Sunday nights. And so when we get to chapter 13, I'm going to skip this portion because I've preached it here, and that'll probably happen in probably a month or two from now. And then tonight, I'm going to preach part two. I'm splitting this into two messages. So we're looking at verses 1 through 4 this morning, and then tonight we'll come back and we will look at verses 5 through 8. If you can, also, just hold your place in 2 Peter chapter 1. 2 Peter chapter 1. Because after I read our text, I'm going to just quickly turn there, and I would like us to see what the Bible says there. 2 Peter chapter number 1. But let's begin in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 1 through 4. There the Bible says this: "Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, and have not charity, I am become as a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains, and have not charity, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, and have not charity, it profiteth me nothing. Charity suffereth long and is kind. Charity envieth not, charity vaunteth not itself, is not puffed up." Now, with that text in mind, I want to look at 2 Peter chapter 1 and read verse 7. And we're looking at different aspects and different qualities that need to be added to our faith. And there the Bible says, "And to godliness, brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness, charity." Charity. The question I want to answer this morning, or hope to answer both this morning and tonight, is this: what is love? Let's pray together. Lord, thank you for this time that we have together this morning to look into your word. I pray that it would be helpful and encouraging. Help us to see specifically from your word what love is, not the world's definition of love, but your definition of it. And I pray that it would help us. And I pray that we could emulate the love of the Lord, and that we would see how you have loved us and work to have charity in our own life and in our own heart. In Jesus' precious and holy name we pray. Amen. What is love? That is the question of the hour. It is the question that our world has sought to answer for quite a long time. And if you'll pay attention to popular culture, it's everywhere. Love, or at least referencing love, or talking about love, or pontificating about it, maybe even singing songs or writing entire albums about it. I was an adolescent in the 1990s, and I can remember a particular song that just asked this question: what is love? What is love? To which the answer was, "Baby, don't hurt me. Baby, don't hurt me no more." Now, wipe that out of your mind, okay? And excuse the reference, but I think I use it because although it's comical, it kind of gives an understanding of where our world is. What is love? Well, just don't hurt me, whatever you do. Don't hurt me anymore with it. And on and on it goes. You know, our world has a warped idea and sense of what really love is. There's no true understanding of it. There's no true acknowledgement of what the love of Christ is all about unless a person comes to know the Lord personally. So there's not an idea or an understanding of what true love is. Love for many people, apart from the love of Christ, is nothing more than a fleeting feeling. It might be nothing more than just lust itself. Just look at the relationships in Hollywood. And our world and our culture still to this day tends to put Hollywood on a pedestal, and just look at the attention that's given to the celebrities of our day and the paparazzi that follows them around and the cameras and everything that just goes there and gives attention to that. And yet many of those people and many of those celebrities, their marriages don't last. The commitment that they've made initially doesn't last. And if they even get married at all, it almost seems like for a certain crowd, engagement is the ultimate thing. Not marriage, because if you get married, well, there's a lot that comes with that, and rather than break off a marriage, I think many people would just like to take the easy route and break off an engagement because it's a lot easier. And by the way, people don't consider marriage and the commitment and the love of God that's involved with it today anyhow. Many of them would just assume live together without making marriage and the love of God a priority. Now, I say that understanding the world and culture in which we live. It's everywhere. There's more couples living together today, not married, than married. That's just statistics. Okay, so I understand the culture in which we live. It still doesn't make it right. And it doesn't mean that it's okay. God's way is to love someone as the Lord, as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. And that kind of love involves a real commitment. And committing to someone not just for a little bit of time and not just as long as you feel like committing to them, but committing to someone for a lifetime. And call me old school, that's great, that's fine. I don't mind that. I'm an old soul trapped in a middle-aged guy's body. I used to say an old soul in a young guy's body. Now I can't really quite say that anymore. But I believe the responsibility is with the man to love like Christ loves. It starts with him, and then love is to be reciprocated by the woman in the marriage relationship. But what I want to do is just try to understand love, in particular, as it says it here in this passage, charity. Because charity is something that is really made a priority in this passage. And we understand, according to God's word, that God is love. And we who know him have been the recipients of that love. A wise preacher once said this: there are good things and there are better things, but there is only one best thing that is above all other things. This one thing makes the difference in our lives, in our families, and in our churches, and it is Christ-like charity. Now, we'll never be able to love perfectly as God does, because we're not God, we're human. But we are to strive for it. As a matter of fact, 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 9 commands us to be fervent in charity. The word fervent means to be boiling over. And so we are to be so fervent in our charity, so burning in our charity, and so hot in trying to seek to love people as God loves people, that it's felt, that it's boiling over, so to speak, that we're fervent in it. This means that we are to possess an intense, overwhelming, and unconditional passion for God and for others. Now, this might seem unrealistic or impossible, but fervent charity is possible in the life of the believer because it grows out of Christ's love for us, and it is the greatest form of love that there is. And I don't need to take the time to break down the different types of love, but there are three primary aspects of love that we think about, or types of love. There's the eros love, and that's the intense passion between a husband and a wife, the physical relationship, is a part of that love, and so on. There's Philadelphian love, phileo love. That's a brotherly kindness, a brotherly love, where you like someone like a friend, and you enjoy them as a friend. You really like that person, and you connect on a friend level. But then there is agape love, and it is defined as charity, but also just as love in God's word. It's the love that God has for us. I think we see a glimpse of it in the love that parents have for their children. Every man should truly work to have this type of love for his wife. That we would lay down our lives if needed. That we would give ourselves if necessary because we care so deeply for someone. I'm going to give just a working definition of love, and then we'll look at several thoughts from the passage both this morning and tonight. But I want to say this: love is a specific, concentrated care and commitment for someone to such a degree that you would willfully do anything within your power for that person and their well-being. Now, that's my definition. I think there's nuance in how we can word it. I believe that, you know, we can get into semantics and so forth, but I really thought, I said, Lord, help me. I know I can take all the other definitions of love, but as I thought about it and prayed about it, this is what I think is a good working definition. Again, a specific concentrated care and commitment for someone to such a degree that you would willfully do anything within your power for that person and their well-being. Now, with that in mind, notice how God's word describes charity. First of all, number one, charity suffers long. It suffereth long. Look again with me in verse 4. Charity suffereth long and is kind. Unconditional agape love is an ongoing choice and a commitment to love someone regardless of their actions or extenuating circumstances. This is the way that God loves us. And if we're ever going to love someone in the same way, then it's an absolute necessity that our love and affection forbears. We must learn to be long-suffering, that is, forbearing with people. We think about forgiveness, and forgiveness is something that we sometimes consider in a moment. Okay, I forgave you, and now we move on. But if you're in a relationship with anybody for any amount of time, you know that you have to forgive more than just one time. Maybe for the same thing. That's forbearance. That's long-suffering. That's forgiving over and over and over again. As a matter of fact, this is important and crucial in any marriage relationship. I think sometimes we have it in our mind, well, you really hurt my feelings in what you did or said there, and I'll forgive you this one time. But boy, if you make that same mistake again, or you do that again, it's over. Or I'm writing you off. Well, that's not what forbearance is all about. That's not what long-suffering is all about. Forbearance and long-suffering is forgiving again and forgiving again. Now, it's not a license to the other person to just do what they want. And I think sometimes we get worried about that. Well, if I keep having a forgiving spirit, they're going to take advantage of me. But remember what the Lord told his disciples, that we are to forgive 70 times 7. Now, I think there's a way that we can conduct ourselves in that we have enough respect for God and respect for our own self that we don't allow someone just to do whatever they want, that we do hold our loved ones accountable in how they behave towards us and towards others. We can't just allow anything to go and, okay, well, whatever, that wouldn't be right or proper. However, we do need to forbear. We do need to love. We need to extend forgiveness over and over again. If we could get that down, I think it would help a lot of relationships. Because I dare say that there are some wives who are bitter against their husbands because he's a knucklehead. And he's working to try to get that same thing right over and over again. And you think to yourself, why can't he get this right? Because he's a guy. And he's a knucklehead. And it takes us some time. Maybe the rest of our lives. to finally get it figured out. What do? Do we write them off? Do we say, forget you? Do we close our heart off? No, that's not the heart of the Lord. That's not having charity. But it's deciding again to say, well, we're going to keep working towards where we need to be, because I'm not perfect either, and I love him. Even though he's a knucklehead, he's my knucklehead. And I'm going to choose to love him. I'm going to choose to forgive him. I'm going to choose to be long-suffering. Remember, God is our example. God's our example. And if we keep him as our example, it'll help us tremendously. This kind of love makes an impact. Charity. Agape. Unconditional love. Notice, even as we read the passage, Paul said, I can do a lot of things, but if I don't have charity, I'm nothing. That's true, isn't it? We can say a lot, do a lot, be a lot, but without charity, it all really amounts to not much at all. He said, I can speak with the tongues of men, even of angels, but if I don't have charity, I'm just like a sounding brass and a tinkling cymbal. Have you ever gone to an orchestra and watched them play and they warm up their instruments before? And it's kind of a little unnerving. You're like, wow, I'm glad they're not doing that the rest of the night. It's like, what are they doing? Well, they're just warming their instruments up. They're not performing the actual song. And Paul says, you know, you can sound a lot like that if you don't have love in your heart. You can present yourself a certain way. You can have the instrument. You can have the position. You can do that. But in the end, if you don't have love, you're completely missing it entirely. He said, I might have the gift of prophecy. I might be able to preach. I might be able to understand all mysteries and knowledge. And I might be able to really decipher and understand God's word. I might have great faith so that I could even remove mountains. I could really have some great qualities that the Lord calls us to have and wants us to have. But if I don't have charity, it amounts up to nothing. He says, I am nothing. You can give your goods to feed the poor. You can do good works. You can even give your own body to be burned and still be doing it with the wrong intention. Think about that. Some people could give their own body and their own life and still have the wrong motive in doing so. Now, I hope that any of us, if we were to get to that place where we're going to give our body to be burned, my hope and prayer is that we have the right motive in doing so. But it just shows how we can quickly get away from what matters and what's important and having love in our heart towards God and towards people, even especially those people who are closest to us. So charity suffers long. Here's the second thought this morning. It's kind. It is kind. I alluded to it earlier, but wrapped within that agape love are all the elements of Philadelphian love. So within that charity that God has for people, there is also that Philadelphian love, where there's not just a love for someone, but there's a true like for somebody. You ever said this? I love you, but I just don't like you right now. Yeah, and there are certain people that are good at that. You love them. You're commanded to love them, but you just don't like them. I don't like you. I don't like you at all. And I'm going to love you because God says we have to love. Well, listen, if we are saying we love someone, but we don't like them, then we're really not loving them properly. Because true love, charity, not only does it suffer long with people, but it's kind. There's a real kindness within charity. Genuine kindness and common courtesy should be a hallmark of our unconditional love for those God has placed in our lives. It just ought to be there. Now, again, being humans, knowing our human nature, it can be easy to take people for granted. And we can grow accustomed to the blessing that people are in our lives. Unfortunately, sometimes familiarity does breed contempt. And we do take people for granted that we should never take for granted. And we ought to show a lot more kindness and common courtesy to those that God has blessed us with, and to our spouse, and to our children, to our parents.
Sometimes we can be guilty of showing more kindness and common courtesy to an absolute stranger than we do to our own loved ones. That should never be the case for any of us as God's people. We show kindness to the waiter or the waitress. We show kindness to people around us. But then, boy, we get in our homes or we get with the people that we know best and that we're most familiar with, and that kindness completely goes away. May God help us. May God help me. Because you know what I'm good at? I'm good at being the nice guy to everyone. But then sometimes the people I'm most familiar with, that I know the best, I can easily lose my kindness with. So may God help us. True love is kind. Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 32 says this: Be ye kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. We just need to be kind. We need to work at it. We need to work at our reactions and our responses. I can be a kind guy as long as everyone's doing everything I want them to do, right? But you cross me, so help me, you cross me, and I'm not gonna like that very much. And I'm praying that God would help me to be a more kind dad, a more kind husband, a more kind pastor. I want to be truly, genuinely kind. Last night, Johnny was downstairs and I was upstairs, and I don't know what he was doing. I think he had his Nintendo Switch, and we'll let him play for an hour or so sometimes in the evenings. And he was playing that downstairs, and I was upstairs, and he came up, and it was time for him to go to bed. And I know one of the things he does when he's concentrating on something like that, he has a habit. And now none of you tell this to him now, okay? This is our secret, because he's in junior church. But sometimes he'll suck on his shirt, you know? He'll get his shirt up in his mouth, you know, and he'll suck on that part of his shirt. And he walked up, and I saw that big suck mark right there. He had that, and I said, Johnny, look at that. You sucked on your shirt. You got a big wet ringer on your shirt, you know? And I knew that he was not happy that I confronted him on that. And he said, I'm sorry. It's a bad habit, you know? And I said, but Johnny, you can't do that. You're going to mess your shirt up, and you need to break that bad habit. Sorry, it's a bad habit, Dad. And he was about to break. And I thought to myself, you know what? I need to just say, I know that it's a habit. And I know that it's something that you don't do. All I'm saying is just try to think about it. And he said, and he just walked, and he calmly walked away, you know. And sometimes we just need to answer softly. We don't need to crush our child. We don't need to let them know how disappointed we are all the time. A lot of people have been very gracious with us. And for us to turn around and not offer that same grace can sometimes be very hurtful and harmful and damaging. So what do we work on? Being kind, tenderhearted, forgiving. Just forgive folks. Even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven us. Remember, ultimately, we've been forgiven by God. And if there's anyone who's been most offended or had a right to be most offended, it's God. Our sin is an offense to him, and yet he has provided a way for us to be forgiven of that sin. What an incredible thing the Lord has done for us. That he sent his son Jesus Christ to become the propitiation for our sins. It should be us on the cross crucified for our own sins. But Jesus took our place and he shed his blood willingly, so that we could be forgiven. So that if we'll place our faith and trust in Jesus Christ and what he did for us and his shed blood for us, we can have our sins forgiven and we can have our souls saved. That's the gospel right there. And within the gospel is incredible forgiveness. It's time for us to get busy offering it as well. So charity suffers alone. It's kind. Notice this. It envies not. The word for envy here literally means to be zealous against or even to be anxious towards. Charity knows nothing of envy, jealousy, or discontented desire for what someone else has or for what someone else is. It rejoices in the triumphs of those we love, and it sorrows in the disappointments and losses of those we love. Don't envy your friends, just be a friend. Don't compete with those you love, just love them. Social media has not helped us in this regard. Social media has brought about a great comparison situation that we sometimes find ourselves involved in, and we say to ourselves, why does he always look happy in all his social media posts? And how come it seems like he and his spouse have such a great relationship? And how come it seems like, you know, he can do no wrong on the job and everything's getting just posted as this great experience that he's having or she's having? And if we're not careful, we can see that and we can say, you know, my life's not like that. What's wrong with me? I wish I was more like that. I wish I had what they had. And first and foremost, what they're doing could be just a lot of presenting something that's not reality. But even if it is reality, our heart should be this. Well, praise the Lord. God is good to them. And I don't need a thing that they have to be happy because, after all, God's been good to me as well. Amen? Amen. Please don't think that what you have is not awesome. Because if God meant it for you, it's tremendous because it's for you. The house you live in is the house that God wants you to have for now. Enjoy it. Thank God for it. You might not always live in that same house, but it's the house God provided for you. If the vehicle you're driving right now, you're not too excited about, just be thankful you have something that gets you from point A to point B. Sometimes. All right? Unless it's I better be careful. I'm not going to say what I was just about to say. I might split the church. Boy, I almost got myself in hot water there. I'm not naming what type or brand of vehicle, but some of them don't make it as far as others. But what I'm saying is, listen, if you have a vehicle, praise the Lord for it. Don't envy someone else's spouse. I have found that we might think someone's great until you really get to know that person. And you realize they're not near as great as I thought they were. Work on your marriage. Work on your relationship. Don't desire or want another relationship. A lot of people get themselves in a lot of trouble that way. We get our eyes on thinking we need someone else to truly be happy. And that's a never-ending spiral. And they find out the next person didn't make them happy. Maybe they were even worse than the first one. So they try again, and that person didn't work out either, and they try again and again, only to find out that maybe that wasn't the issue. Don't be envious. True love doesn't envy the other. True love doesn't compete with the other. Don't look at your spouse as someone that you're competing with. I've already gotten on the men a little bit. Let me speak to the ladies for just a moment. God didn't give you a husband so that you could compete with him. We live in a mixed up world that tells our women, anything that a man can do, you can also do, when you weren't designed to do everything that a man can do. Don't look at your husband as competition. Don't think you're to compete with him. You're to complement him and do the things that he's not good at doing, to make his life wonderful. Yeah, that's okay to say. Woman was created as a helpmeet for man. God gave woman to man to make his life better. Because without you, our lives are a lot worse. Find value in that. I'm not saying anything the least bit chauvinistic. I'm just trying to be biblical. Your presence in his life makes his life better. And you should not look at that situation and say, well, I'm not just here to make his life good. Well, actually, yeah, you are. And in doing so, your life will be much better because you're fulfilling the role that God gave you. So don't envy. Be thankful. Men, love your wives. Don't look at your wife as someone that you are insecure about. If God gave you a capable woman, praise the Lord for that. Let her do the things that she can do well. And don't say to yourself, well, boy, I don't measure up. Just say, thank God I married over my head. That's a gift. Because if you married over your head, and we all did, you understand what a blessing she is. Don't look at her as someone to contempt. Don't look at her as someone to devalue. Look at her as someone who has added great value to your life. We see this fourth and finally. It vaunteth not itself. It is not puffed up. When we genuinely love, we won't have a desire to outwardly express our blessings, our accomplishments, and all of our good things before others. It's one thing to share a praise or a blessing in a way that gives glory to God. And we should do that. I like when we have praise times where we share praises, and we should share how good God has been. But it's something all to get together different to be outright boastful and to become a continual braggart about yourself and your life, especially when those you say you love may not possess the same blessings. Again, I think social media has not helped us with this. Use social media as a way to praise and give glory to God, but not yourself. Use it as a way to help others where they are, but not just to constantly put yourself in a place where you are uplifting your own life and your own experience. Now, I get it. We have different personalities out there, and some people, they're not necessarily being boastful. They're just being themselves. And being themselves is putting themselves out there. And some people just are attention seekers by nature, okay? And boy, you're going to find attention one way or another. If someone's not giving it to you, you're going to find a way to get their attention. You know? And I know personality plays into this. But overall, let me just help us. Love does not build us up and put others down. Love helps anyone wherever they are. We don't exist to just show everyone how great we are. A wise preacher once said, he who tooteth his own horn, said horn will go untooted. Some people can't help but just try to gobble up all the attention all of the time. Sometimes my girls will come home, and it's interesting because I didn't really grow up with sisters other than with Casey, and she was a lot younger than me. So when she was going through junior high and high school, I was out of the house by then. But now I have my own daughters who are in junior high and high school, and I'm very aware of, you know, who the other girls are in their class, and, you know, there is always some prima donnas around. And there is always some girls that are going to do whatever they can to try to get all the attention on them. It doesn't matter what they have to do. I mean, they'll fall out of their chair and act like they fainted. They'll act, you know, like they're about on death's door. They don't care what they have to do. They're going to try to get all eyes on them. And you know what a godly person does? A godly person tries to reflect attention off themselves and more onto the Lord. This life is not about us. Some of this generation need a rude awakening. They need somebody to take them and just psh, 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 wake up. Life is not about you. Amen. And part of the problem is parents feed into that and they make them think that life is all about them. Well, it's not. We're here for the glory of God. And we understand that life is not about us. Listen, if love was insular and self-centered, Jesus would have never come, and he would have never gave himself to be our sacrifice. But he did because he saw us. He saw beyond himself. Being puffed up has the same meaning as vaunteth, but it denotes an inner quiet pride as opposed to an outward boasting. To blow, puff, inflate with pride or vanity. Some of us have a problem not with necessarily vaunting ourselves, but being inwardly puffed up. We don't go about loudly proclaiming how good we are, but there's a quiet inner pride that's there. And it might not be as noticeable as someone who wears their emotion on their sleeves, but if some digging and probing were to happen, there's some real pride in the heart. It might be quieter. It might not be so easily seen, but there is a real pride there. Listen, lose it. In this statement, we see both the expression and the feeling of pride, and it can destroy love and relationships more quickly than almost anything else. God, help us not to be that way. I can remember early on, and none of you would know who I'm talking about, but very early on, there was a couple in the church, probably within the first 6 months or so that their church started, and then they were having some real severe marital problems, and the marriage was really coming apart at the seams. And I can remember talking to them on a couple of occasions, and the problem with both parties was pride. One of them was really outward about it. It was the guy. And he was just, he was as proud and as smug and as full of himself as he could be. I found out that the wife also had pride, but it was quieter. And neither of them could give up their own pride. And I can remember, here I am, a 26-year-old pastor trying to help this couple. And it was like fireworks were going off in the living room. I thought the whole house was going to come down. They were so seething with anger at each other because neither of them could see past their own pride. And unfortunately, that marriage didn't last. There has to be a real dying to self. When we believe our own press clippings or even our own inwardly prideful notions about ourselves, we're headed for failure. Failed opportunities, failed relationships, and a failed future. You know what we need to do? Die to self and yield to the Spirit. I think some people want to know how we can be filled with the power of the Spirit. That's the key. Die to self first and then yield to what the Spirit wants to do in your life. If we have the Holy Spirit, and if we're saved, we do, that should be something that we're doing every day. Saying, Lord, it's not me, not my will, not my choice, not what I'm trying to do, not what I'm trying to get across, not always my way or the highway, but Holy Spirit, you show me. I'm yielding to you. And you have said, love my wife. Well, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to love my wife. Holy Spirit, your word has said that I am to reverence my husband. Well, you know what? That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to set aside my pride and myself, and I'm going to give him honor. I'm going to give him reverence. You know what will happen? God will begin to work in your relationship. He'll be able to do some real work if you're yielding to the Spirit and what God's word has so clearly said. Saul is a tragic figure in the Old Testament, and pride was his main problem. And when Samuel confronted him, here's what he said to him in 1 Samuel chapter 15 and verse 17. He said, when thou wast little in thine own sight, wast thou not made the head of the tribes of Israel, and the Lord anointed thee king over Israel? When you were little in your own sight, you were going places. God was promoting you. You became king over all Israel because God saw that you were not a proud man. You were little in your own sight. You didn't think much of yourself. And God can use someone like that. But you know the problem, Saul? You became puffed up with pride and ego. And it's why you disobeyed. And it's why the kingdom is now being taken from you. Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 8. We sometimes refer to this as the great kenosis passage. But there, the Bible gives us a wonderful insight into this kind of heart. Where the Bible says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself, and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. It's time some of us humble ourselves. Jesus humbled himself so that we could have eternal life. If he didn't do so, it would never be possible for us. But he did. And he became obedient unto death. He so humbled himself that he was obedient to his Father all the way to the point of a torturous death. Even the death of the cross. But he did that because he loves us. By the way, if you'll receive that, it'll save your soul and it'll change your life forever. And if you live that yourself moving forward, it'll help every relationship you have. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes, please? With heads bowed and eyes closed, let me just ask you, have you received what Christ has done for you? He truly does love you, and he did humble himself. And he did give his life a ransom for many, and he went to the cross, and he endured that torturous death on the cross. Praise the Lord, 3 days later, he rose from the grave. And if you'll put your faith and trust in Jesus as God and what he did for you on Calvary, it can save your soul. I wonder if there might be somebody here who would say, I need to make that decision. I need to trust in Jesus Christ. I'm not sure that I'm saved, but I want to get it settled right now. You know, you can do that right now. Just call upon the Lord quietly in your seat. Don't say this prayer to anyone else or for anyone else, but say it to the Lord because you believe it. But just say, Dear God, I acknowledge that I'm a sinner. But I believe that Jesus is God in the flesh and that he was crucified, buried, and rose from the dead. And I'm placing my faith and trust in that alone and what he did for me to save my soul. I wonder, with heads bowed and eyes closed, would there be somebody who would say, I just said that to the Lord, Pastor. I just prayed it. Just put your hand up and put it down. Amen. I see that hand. Praise the Lord. You know the Lord as Savior, let's ask him for help to start loving like him. We need to love like the Lord loves, and we need to look to his example. Charity is love perfected. And we won't ever get it perfect, but we should be striving for that Christ-like charity every day. To love unconditionally, to love with brotherly kindness. Let's ask God for help in this. Let's be a loving person, a kind person, a helpful person in all that we're doing. The Lord can help you. And if we give ourselves to him, he'll bring us right to where we need to be. Father, help us in this invitation. Thank you for one who raised their hand, acknowledging that they trusted in you. Lord, if there's others, I pray that they would make that same decision. Lord, I pray that you would help us to love like the Savior. Our world is mixed up on what love is. Help us to know what it is from your word and choose to follow after it. If we mess up, I pray that we'd fess up and get it right and work to be a more loving Christian. We keep looking to you as our example. Help us as we go. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you stand with me, please, quietly? I'm going to ask Holly to play a verse or two of invitation. And listen, whatever the need might be, would you come to the front and you can pray right at the altar? If you made a decision for Christ, you can come and I'd love to just pray with you and talk to you about that now or after the service. But listen, why don't we come? Why don't we take a moment and just say, Lord, thank you for your love for me. I want to live with love that you have exampled for us. thank you for being here this morning. I'd encourage you to come back this evening at 5, okay, not 6, but 5 o'clock. If you come at 6, we'll be pretty much done. And so come at 5, and I'm going to preach the second part of this message about what love is from God's Word. I hope it'll be a help to you. If you are visiting today, I hope my wife and I will get a chance to just to meet you and say hello. Heather and I will be in the lobby, and we want to just get a chance to say hello and learn just a little bit about who you are. Thank you so much for coming today. Good to see several visitors with us. Again, if you've not talked to Cullen yet, let them know. Man, we're so glad you're doing well, and God has been good. And that's a loving family, the T-shirt family. They've all rallied around him in love, and I know that that's helped him a great deal. And so they've been a good example in that. And we love you folks and are praying for you. And let's continue to pray for him. Pray for BJ as he takes off tomorrow for Missouri. And we'll look to the Lord in all of these things. Let's be dismissed now in a word of prayer. Brother Neil Atkinson, would you dismiss us, please?